Welcome everyone to our last webinar of 2022. And the topic of the webinar is GRADE for Multiple Intervention Comparisons in Evidence to Decision Framework. So today we will talk about GRADE for Multiple Intervention Comparisons in Evidence to Decision Framework. And at the end, we will show you the new GRADEpro module that allows you to create multiple interventions ETD tables. And we have a great pleasure to host our guest speakers today. First, Jessica Beltran. She holds a medical degree and a master's degree in epidemiological research. Currently, she is a researcher at the Iberoamerican Cochrane Center and the Barcelona GRADE Center. Her work focuses on conducting evidence synthesis research to support informed decision making and clinical practice guideline development. Second, we have Pablo Alonso Coelho. He's a senior researcher at the Iberoamerican Cochrane Center, Biomedical Research Institute, San Pau. He holds a PhD in medicine and is a specialist in family practice. He's a member of the GRADE guidance group and of the gene board, and he's in charge of the Barcelona GRADE Center. His work focuses on developing methods to improve decision making with a special focus in guidelines and improving the consideration of different relevant aspects like the patient perspective. He also leads research projects in primary care in the area of the antibiotic prescription and shared decision-making. Next, Carlos Canelo Aybar. He's internal medicine physician with the postgraduate training in clinical epidemiology, public health and health economics. He also holds a PhD degree in methods of biomedical research and public health. He's currently a researcher at the Iberoamerican Cochrane Center and member of the GRADE Working Group, also co-leader of the GRADE Modeling Evidence Group. His work focuses on conducting systematic reviews and synthesis of economic evidence as methodologies for clinical practice guidelines and on the development of methods for health decision making. A huge pleasure to welcome you here today with us. And finally, a member of our team, Bart Dietl, who is the head of the product development at Evidence Prime. And he will present today the new model developed in GRADEpro, which allows us to create multiple interventions ETDs tables. So thank you very much. And Jessica, I give the floor to you.
Okay, hello everybody. My name, as Claudia said, my name is Pablo Alonso, and I work at the Iberoamerican Cochrane Center and the Barcelona GRADE Center here in Barcelona. Let me see if the slides are working. Okay, these are our disclosures, no direct financial conflicts, GRADE Center and Cochrane Center, and the views are our own. However, we will be presenting the work that is ongoing, and it's a pleasure to present next, of the GRADE Working Group, the work on the developed by the Evidence to Decision Frameworks Project Group, myself. So the first, the agenda for today, I will do a brief introduction and then give the floor to Jessica, that she will be specifically talking about the multiple interventions evidence to decision frameworks. Next. And just a recap about GRADE for those who are not familiar. GRADE is a system that facilitates or helps groups of people to synthesize the evidence by mainly grading the certainty of the evidence or bodies of evidence. And this is both common for reviews and for guidelines, but it also facilitates the development of recommendations or the formulation of decisions, including recommendations. Next. And most of all, it's a system that it's built to be transparent, structured, and comprehensive. Next. Okay, so moving from evidence to a decision is complex. And GRADE has two different types of formulation of two types of recommendations, strong and conditional, taking into consideration different factors. And for that, given that it's a complex process, the frameworks have been developed. So basically the frameworks help panels to move from the evidence to a decision, including a recommendation, informing judgments, and that they are making. So it helps them also consider all the criteria, so consider all the relevant criteria. It helps structure the discussion and make the decisions transparent. Basically, apart from formulating the PICO, so it has three sections, the PICO section on the background or PICO background section, then the criteria, and then the summary of the judgments and the recommendations. Summary of the judgment. The judgments, what are we judging? We're judging 12 different criteria, starting from the problem, the magnitude of the desirable and undesirable, certainty of effects, certainty of evidence, how people value the outcomes, balance, resources, cost effectiveness, equity, acceptability, and feasibility. All that in a structured format. Next. For each criterion, the panel has to make judgments. You probably are, most of you are aware, but we are just going briefly over the basic framework, the basics of the framework. And those judgments are ideally informed by a systematic review of the evidence, but also complemented with the considerations of the panel that might be needed for the different criteria included. After going all through the judgments, which are many, as you have seen, there is the summary of the judgment, which is a map of the judgments made across the relevant criteria to help the panel moving to the process of going from the judgments across the criterion to the actual recommendation. The recommendations, right, are, as I mentioned before, strong or conditional, in favor or against, taking into consideration of these judgments. And what we have presented up to now, it's the work that the GRADE working group has conducted to develop the frameworks, which at the moment they are only developed for pairwise comparisons, for single pairwise comparisons. And this is where we start. We had frameworks for simple comparisons, but most of the scenarios that we find, we have more than one comparison and several interventions. And what we had up to now was the possibility of doing a single framework, one framework for each one of the comparisons and then compare across. But it was experienced by many of the developers as a very tedious and burdensome process. And this is what we've been doing and working now in the project group on GRADE to make the process more efficient into a single ETD framework for multiple comparisons.
Yes, and as Pablo mentioned,
they have to do several ETDs to assess multiple comparisons for one health problem can be time consuming and can be burdensome. And nowadays we frequently face scenarios where there are several treatment options available for one problem or condition. And in order to make useful recommendations, we have to simultaneously compare all the relevant interventions. And then the recommendations should ideally, to be truly helpful, include an order of preference among these options to support decision makers. So our work, the work that we are going to present today, is based on this first GRADE concept paper published in 2021. In this paper, they described the steps, the general steps that the multiple intervention comparisons approach consists about. No? So the first is the planning and priority setting, evidence synthesis, the ETD framework itself to completing the ETD framework, the assessment of the transitivity of the interventions, the rating of each of the interventions across the ETD criteria, the recommendations across all the interventions, and finally, the dissemination. Now we are going to present what we have been working on through the last 1 year and a half, and it's the grade guidance. So these are the steps that we are going to explain step by step today. First, we start with the planning and the priority setting. Then we do the evidence synthesis and the building of the summary of findings table, the ETD framework, where we complete all the judgments, the rating of the interventions using the multiple comparison matrix, and the recommendations that include the previous judgments that we have explained to set an order of preference or to differentiate the recommendations between the for the interventions. Let's start with the planning and priority setting. First of all, we have to consider all the possible interventions that are available for our health care question. Then we have to assess the potential conduction of an NMA. So we have to assess if it's feasible and if it's appropriate to conduct a network meta-analysis. Then we have to assess transitivity. In this case, for our framework, we use an analogous construct of transitivity, as in the network meta-analysis, where we are going to see if it's appropriate to compare the interventions considering the populations and the outcomes. Then we are going to select a common reference to present results. This is very important because in this way, we can, for example, in the grade guidance for the NMA, they also there is a need to use a common reference to present the results. So we are going to use this to have a better description of the effects of all the interventions. Then we have to use a healthcare, to select the healthcare context and to set decision thresholds. When we do the healthcare context, our approach suggests to use the partially contextualized approach. And the decision thresholds will divide our effects or will classify our effects in small, in trivial, small, moderate, and large. Then we are going to do the evidence synthesis. And for this, we have designed an approach that is flexible. We can use the network meta-analysis if appropriate, or we could use multiple pairwise comparisons. Then we are going to build the summary of finding tables. If we use an NMA, we have to use the NMA, the grade NMA soft, and here you can find the reference to see that there's guidance to build these tables already. And then we are going to complete the ETD for multiple interventions. So to complete these ETDs, we have to consider each of the interventions across all the ETD criteria that Pablo has described for the regular or standard ETD framework. And then we are going to complete the summary of judgments matrix for all the interventions, and then do a rating for each of the interventions. And for this, we're going to use a two-stage approach. Why do we want to use to divide this in a two-stage? Because we want to be as explicit as possible and transparent as possible so that the final recommendation can depict all the criteria that the panel has considered. So for the first stage, we are going to assess each intervention versus the common reference across all the ETD criteria that we already know. And in a second stage, we are going to compare interventions relative to each other and to rate them. So let's see how we do this. First of all, we have designed a single ETD framework with a multiple judgments grid for all criteria. In this way, we avoid the necessity of needing to populate many ETD frameworks or as many ETD frameworks as interventions we have. And we have to do this for all interventions versus the common comparator. So this is the general structure of the multiple judgments grid for each criteria. We have, for each domain, we'll have a column or a row for each of the interventions, and then we'll have the judgment. We have to make a judgment per outcome, and then a judgment across outcomes or an overall judgment, as in this case, for example, that we can see here. Now, to complete the desirable effects, the undesirable effects, the net balance, the certainty of the evidence, the values, and the balance of effect, we have to consider the thresholds. So as in early in the process, we recommend setting these thresholds in order to be more efficient, more consistent, and to avoid deciding during the recommendation meetings. So here, what we do is we have the effects and we divide the effects in categories according to their magnitude. We'll have trivial effect, small effect, small beneficial effects, moderate beneficial effects, large beneficial effects, and we do the same in the other direction, in the harm direction. These thresholds can be set through a discussion of the panel or through surveys, and these are the more simple ways to do it, or we can have more structured methods that include the agreement of health outcome definitions using health outcome descriptors, or the agreement on the importance of health outcomes using utilities. More sophisticated methods are going to be published soon for the GRADE approach as well, where you can empirically derive what is a large, a moderate, a small, or a trivial effect size, regardless of the outcome. But you can also do it, as in this example, in a very simple way. Now, in this case, for example, for this living COVID guideline, the outcome of hospitalization was divided in trivial effect, meaning that if the hospitalization reduction was less than 10 per 1,000, it was considered a trivial effect. If it was from 10 to 25 per 1,000 less hospitalizations, it was considered a small beneficial effect, and so on. And this was considered by the publication to be a valuable addition to the recommendations formulation process. Now, after this is, for example, for desirable effects, we can do the judgments first per outcome and then per intervention. So let's see the judgments about how substantial the effects should take into consideration two things: the magnitude of effects, which is the proportion of people who would benefit, and the importance of the outcome, which is how people value the outcome. Let's see a real example. The ACP guideline for low back pain in this publication that we can find in this publication conducted an NMA to assess the evidence of effects. And first, as we have established in our process, we set the thresholds. No, this is hypothetical. The guideline did not include all these thresholds, but we base the small beneficial on the minimal important difference. And for example, here for the gastrointestinal related adverse events, we see that a reduction of 100 events is considered a small beneficial. A reduction in 150 events is considered a moderate beneficial, and a reduction of 200 is considered a large beneficial effect. Now, after having all the thresholds and all our effects categorized, we can categorize, or we can interpret our findings and classify them according to their magnitude. So for example, the topical NSAID for pain relief that had a reduction of -1.02 is considered a beneficial effect. Now that we have all the table completed, this can automatically be used to populate the desirable effects multiple intervention grid. And this is more efficient, it's consistent, and it's easier, no? It reduces time. Then we do the judgments across outcomes for each intervention. Here, we have to consider the critical outcomes, and we have to consider that they are independent. The overall effect cannot be smaller than the largest magnitude of effects. It's the general guidance that we follow from GRADE, and it's the same that for standard ETDs. In this example, we see that we have two small effects for pain reduction, and in this case, because we have two ways to measure pain, we can only consider one. So we consider the first one, and then we have physical function that it's moderate. And since we have small and moderate, and our final judgment cannot be smaller than moderate. So our overall judgment is that the topical NSAID is at least moderate overall, no, across outcomes for desirable effects. Then we do the same for the undesirable effects. And when we have both, we have to do the net balance. The net balance is a new criteria that we have introduced for this approach that quantifies the relationship between desirable and undesirable effects. We have to note that we do not consider or do not take into consideration the certainty of the evidence yet. Here we only make we quantify the relationship of the magnitude of effects. This may facilitate the articulation of the balance of effect and the comparisons across interventions, and may help later on to to build a ranking of the interventions. So the options for this new criterion will be from large net desirable to large net undesirable. Then we have the certainty of the evidence. Here we also follow the general GRADE guidance for standard pairwise comparisons that states that if the quality of evidence differs across critical outcomes, the lowest quality of the evidence for any of the critical outcomes determines the overall quality of the evidence. We have to point out also that if we are using an NMA, we have to follow the GRADE NMA approach for assessing the certainty of the evidence, which considers the direct evidence, and you consider these factors that you can see here, then it rates the certainty of the evidence of the indirect estimates, and finally, the rating of the certainty of the evidence of the NMA estimates. Now, then, after we have done this, we go to the values, the importance of uncertainty and variability. So here we also follow the general guidance for standard pairwise comparisons, it may vary across interventions depending on the net balance. Then we have to judge the balance of effects. The balance of effects considers all the previous criteria that I have just explained. So we as following general GRADE guidance, no? So what we have recommended now is to have a table that summarizes these criteria for each of the interventions in a way that we can consider all of them simultaneously to judge the balance. Now, the rest of the criteria that are resources required, the certainty of resources required, cost effectiveness, equity, acceptability, and feasibility, use the standard judgments categories, but for each intervention. So let's see an example. Here we have cost effectiveness. So what we will have is a multiple grid for each of the interventions, and we'll have to populate it them with the judgment that we make for cost effectiveness for each of the interventions, and so on for the rest of the interventions. At the end, we'll have a summary of judgments where we'll have all the interventions and each of the criteria that we have assessed. We'll have here a map of the judgments to make decisions. Then we'll have a multiple comparison matrix to rank or rate the interventions per criterion also, no? And for this multiple comparison, we'll use the START system that panels have found an intuitive approach to rate and rank the interventions. Here we rank the interventions relative to each other, so that 5 stars means that the intervention is the most favorable across criteria, and the 1 star would mean that is the least favorable intervention in the criteria that we are assessing. So the table looks like this. The summary of judgment tables, for example, for this example of ventilation versus no ventilation, we have the interventions here in the columns, and then we have all the criteria, and we have a map of all the judgments that were made for each of the interventions. Then the interventions are rated using the STAR systems, and this will help us to cluster the interventions so that the recommendations can include an order of preferences. And then we know which are our favorite interventions and which are the least favorite, and this will support decision makers to make a truly useful recommendations. Now, this is a map that you may be familiar with, but we have modified this, including the new steps that we have just explained for the approach. We start formulating the question and assessing the possibility of including all the interventions that are relevant. Then we assess the possibility to make an NMA and assess the transitivity among all these interventions. We select the outcomes and rate their importance as always, but then we set the thresholds early in the process so that we can increase consistency and efficiency when the time of decisions come. Then we summarize the evidence, and we can, for this approach, because this has been designed to be a flexible approach, we could include an NMA evidence, or we could include evidence coming from different pairwise comparisons or meta-analysis. Then we rate the evidence, the certainty of the evidence. And here we have to differentiate if we are using NMA or if we are using pairwise evidence. If we're using pairwise evidence, we use the same criteria that Pablo explained to us. But if we are using the NMA, we'll have to use the great NMA certainty of the evidence approach. Then to interpret the NMA findings, we have to use the partially contextualized framework that divides the effects into categories of trivial, small, moderate, and large magnitude of effects. And we, from using this information, we have to choose the ones that have also the highest certainty of the evidence to go to the next steps that are the formulation of the recommendations. Then we have to grade the overall quality of the evidence now across outcomes based on the lowest quality of the critical outcomes. And once we have all this information, the panels will find this information in the ETDs and they can make the judgments for each of the criterion that we have briefly explained, no? And that you can see here in the bottom part of the graph. After having complete all this information, the panels have to make a rating among the interventions and use this rating to formulate recommendations that can differentiate that can be differentiated in clusters and can be useful for decision makers or clinicians or anyone that at the end of the day needs to make a decision on one intervention among the rest of the interventions. So this is the process. And as a conclusion, we can say that this approach for multiple comparisons depicts the simultaneous assessment across ETD criteria in a single framework, which is to be more efficient, to reduce burdensome, and it's faster. Recommendations need to reflect the ranking of the interventions in order to be useful for decision makers. This is a flexible approach, yet it's still structured and explicit. And there are still some challenges that we are working on, and the GRADE guidance is coming soon and soon to be published or submitted to publication. So thank you very much. And we are ready to answer any questions. Also, feedback and suggestions are very welcome. This is our email and the Twitter of the GRADE Barcelona Center. So please, any feedback is very, very welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jessica, Pablo. It was a really interesting presentation. There are already some questions which are being answered by Pablo in the Q&A section. And there is one question in the chat. What criteria are there for the panels to rate the intervention in addition to the intuitive?
Yes, this is a very good question. And we are working in more structured guidance to tell panels how they can assess the or they can rate the interventions among each other. But this is still work in progress, but it is true that some panelists may need more than this intuitive star system, a qualitative star system, let's say, no? So the new approaches that we are analyzing include more quantitative approaches, but as I said, still work in progress, and I did not present it because we still have to figure out some gaps.
There is another question. We'll share the article reference again, and we will share it in the chat, I believe, in a moment. And another one in the chat, if there are more than one critical outcome with a very different certainty of evidence as large and trivial, how can we rate it?
Well, that's also a very important question, because sometimes we have critical outcomes that are more critical, you know, one is more critical than the other. So maybe when Bart shows you the GRADEpro, you will see that there is an option to quantify how important is an outcome in a more numeric way. So that would be one way to do it, no? For example, if one critical outcome has a score of 9, then this can be a driver of the panel's decision, no? If the other critical outcome have a less points. This is up to the panel, but this is something that can be considered during the panel discussion. Maybe Bart can show it then, but I think, yeah, there are some critical outcomes that can be drivers of the decision, no?
Perfect. So maybe we answer one more question before going to Bart's presentation. Must the magnitude of effect threshold be symmetric? For example, for an intervention for preventing death, we might define the threshold for small beneficial as 10 per 1,000. However, must the threshold for small harmful be symmetric 10 to 1,000? For preventive interventions, just one death per 1,000 may be large harmful.
Well, this is also a very good question, and it includes, you know, ethics, no? But what we have done, and mortality is always like a very difficult outcome to assess. But what we have done so far is we have used symmetrical approach, no? So yeah, but it's up to discussion, no? It's a very good question. Maybe Carlos can, no? Oh, I'm sorry. But so far we have used only a symmetrical approach so that the beneficial magnitude thresholds mirror the harmful thresholds, no? But it's a very important point. Thank you for saying that. Jesus.
Okay. Carlos, would you like to add something also, or?
No, I mean, basically what Jessica has said, no? It's true that as far as now we have used asymmetrical approach, but it's also maybe in some specific cases, from societal perspective, maybe the harmful might have different weights, but this is not, it is something that we have not tested yet. So for okay. as for now, it's symmetrical is the typical approach.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much. And I believe that I give the floor to Bart.
Hello everyone, I'm Bart Dietl. I'm product manager here in Evidence Prime. So I wanted to show you today what are our advancements in implementing this framework to GRADEpro. So let me share my screen. So here in the GRADEpro, so this will be a live demo. So this is already live in GRADEpro. So there are several points that we needed to address here in GRADEpro to be able to create this multi-intervention framework, because till now all the questions in GRADEpro were pairwise, right? So there were intervention versus comparison for population. There was only pairwise evidence summary in GRADEpro. Now, we added to, when we were building this new module, and we tried to follow together with how the methodology was designed, we created several prototypes, and we were enhancing it with time, and we tried to work with multiple groups who were implementing what we built. So you have now in fact third version of implementation of this framework. So you'll find in GRADEpro this new button, create overarching question. And this in fact is the gateway to create a question and a container for giving recommendation about multiple interventions. So as you can see, you are able to frame this question quite freely, because we commonly will see that those questions have open form, like what's the optimal treatment or what's the optimal strategy for managing some health problem. And you are able to add multiple interventions here. I'm using this example that Jessica mentioned in her presentation. So this management of acute pain. As you can see, I added several of those interventions. And also because we don't have yet the evidence tables for that, I needed to create a storage for the critical outcomes that we will be assessing in the framework. So here below, you are able to provide your outcomes that you will want to assess. So you are able to enter them all. And after clicking save, you have your question ready. And you can click to enter the ETD. So as you know, perhaps many of you are already familiar with our pairwise ETD. ETD is built out of three sections. So first one is assessment, in which we'll go through those judgments. The second one is rating type of recommendation. So deciding about whether a recommendation for each intervention in this case will be strong or conditional. And in the conclusion sections at the very bottom, we will frame the text of the recommendation or recommendations. I will return to that in a second. So in general, this is built based on principles that Jessica presented. So in the research evidence, of course, you will have your research evidence. For now, this is a screenshot of our NMA table that we use for this module, for this example. Next year, we plan on implementing the module for GRADEpro, which will allow you to import your table directly here to this module. And this will be like live connection, exactly like you have with ETD and summary of findings table now in the pairwise question. So our assessment will be based on the evidence which we have here. And after clicking judgments, you get this table, which will allow you to assess desirable effect for each intervention and each outcome. Obviously, this may be, you know, at this point, you probably for your panel want to have this filled by someone. So for now, you need to do this manually, but you will be doing this based on thresholds, which were already mentioned by Jessica. And this is the second module, which we will probably introduce at some point in GRADEpro. So based on those thresholds and based on the effect from the table, GRADEpro will be able to at least automatically, you know, fill this for you instead of you filling this manually as now, because we need those two things. So effect and the magnitude thresholds. And GRADEpro will be able to group this all together. Of course, you will be able to change this. If there is any reason behind this that you are willing to change the decision, there will always be this possibility. And you have your overall judgment across all outcomes here at the end. And when you fill this, you will see that your interventions are grouped to each of those criteria. So you will see my interventions grouped to trivial, small, moderate, and large. And you will have the same for undesirable effect. So it's quite the same. For the next net balance and all the other criteria, we will utilize your decisions that were made before that, right? So we will show you what were the desirable and undesirable effects and will allow you to decide here on the net balance, right? So you are choosing net balance in this step. In the certainty of evidence, we will be also able to populate it from the evidence table. So this will be pre-populated. You are able to choose only the overall one. Then you have, of course, sections for values when you decide about values and balance of effects, which summarize all of the information for you, giving you the possibility to decide about the balance. Then there are those other criteria like resources required, equity, acceptability, feasibility, in which we will not decide for each intervention and each outcome pair, but we will just decide across outcomes, right? So we have only intervention, and for this intervention, we are deciding what are, in this case, resources required. So we are able to decide about that with a panel. And this applies to all of the other criteria that we have on the list. So finally, here in this module, we have this large table which summarizes all of our choices, which will help us, you know, with the decision. So as Jessica mentioned, this is the table which summarizes our decisions, which are based for each intervention against the common comparator. Now, here at the bottom, we will find this additional assessment when interventions are in fact relatively assessed, right? So relatively to each other, and we are using this star system, allowing the panel to choose how many star each of the intervention is getting for each of those key criteria, right? So you will see that at this point, balance of effects is already a single criterion. We are not assessing again all of those judgments which falls into this balance of effects category, and we are able to assess all of the others. Then below that, we are deciding about the type of recommendation. So we can decide about this, whether this is strong or conditional for or against the intervention, for each intervention. And as Jessica mentioned, both of those will help us cluster and frame our final recommendation or recommendations, because in this case, you are able to not give only a single recommendation, but you can give multiple of them. So I can imagine that you may have a cluster of obviously two, for example, most important or most effective, most best, let's say, treatments, and you will give for them strong recommendation, but you may additionally have a conditional recommendation for some of the others based on some, you know, discussions that the panel made and the evidence that you will have. So you can do multiple of those recommendations, and then at the end you have the standard justification and all the explanation fields for framing the supplementary information about your recommendation. So this is the ETD framework for multiple interventions as we have it now. It's working in GRADEpro at the moment. We are going through a process of beta testing. So we are testing the usability of this with different groups who are willing to, you know, use it in real guidelines and share with us their feedback so we could, you know, enhance the usability and how this can work within GRADEpro ecosystem. Of course, for the future, we have a lot of plans on our roadmap. So this is already in a simple way connected to our model panel voice, in which, you know, panel can make decisions asynchronously on those criteria. So it's simple implementation, and we will enhance it with various functionalities in the future, but this is already working. Of course, under functionalities like possibility to export this to different formats is already working. And, you know, next year, as I said, we will introduce possibility to insert multiple intervention summary of findings table to GRADEpro and insert it directly here to the ETD to you know, help with a lot of those judgments and automate as much as we can to make the work of the panel you know, faster, more efficient. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Thank you, Bart. This was a really nice demonstration of the tool. So I think I will have questions for everybody. I see that Carlos would like to answer the first one. So do you know of any application of the ETD framework in the field of genomic medicine? What do you think are the challenges associated with using the ETD framework when dealing with genetic genomic information? For example, the decision to administer an intervention depends on the results of a genetic test.
Thank you. Yeah, we just write down an answer, but in summary, for genomic test, as any other technology that stratify risks, we should consider the end clinical outcomes after the therapeutic or other intervention decisions that are driven or guided by the information provided by these genomic tests. In terms of examples, we have published a set of recommendations for genotype testing in the field of breast cancer risk assessment for chemotherapy that maybe you may find interested. So I will try to find the publication and share in the chat. So maybe it's useful for you to review. Thank you.
Thank you a lot. We have another question in the chat. Is the overall judgment automated?
Claudia, if I may, there's another question in the chat that is asking, is the overall judgment automated once you complete other fields? No, the automated fields will be the judgment per outcome. The overall judgment needs to be done by the panel. It's quite automated because if you follow the rules, it's very simple to make a decision. But as we have seen in other questions, there are some case scenarios where the panel can assess differently or can have a different opinion or different considerations to make an overall judgment. So the overall judgment, it's not automated. It's up to the panel.
And from the software point, we are in fact planning to add more of this educational materials there to help panel make those decisions. However, we will, as Jessica said, not automate it. Possibly, you know, I'm thinking about solutions which will help enhance the information, maybe providing some additional comment to why some changes were introduced. I think this may be interesting. So those will be enhancements that are coming.
Thank you. There was also a question about where do you see the appropriate use of artificial intelligence in the GRADE workflow lifecycle? I see Pablo already answered. Maybe it's interesting also to provide a comment on this.
Well, I think surely it's promising because it's a technology that it's growing and it's going in every, it's getting into our lives in every single field, no? And a fact is that, for example, it's been introduced in the development of reviews. So surely these technologies will help. And I think that you in Evidence Prime are also very much working on the integration of this kind of technology. However, always bearing in mind, just like with the previous aspect that you mentioned about automatization of decisions, there's always judgment behind, and it has to be reviewed by somebody, or ideally by a group of people afterwards.
Perfect. Yes, surely there's a lot of new things coming in regards to automation. There's one more question. Is the ETD available on GRADEpro now?
So it is being user tested. So a group needs to come to us and, you know, I need to enable this for, so this is for, so this is now going through user testing, and I hope this will become available, you know, widely for groups in GRADEpro next year.
Perfect. So thank you a lot to everybody. Thank you for all the speakers. It was great presentations. We have one more question. Can you share other multiple intervention examples?
Yes, in the GRADE concept paper, there are examples of the how to use a multiple comparison approach. Not this last change of the ETDs, but the approach. For example, we have one example on the breast cancer guideline where you can see three pairwise comparisons with different comparators that were compared at the end using like a sequential logic of thinking. And they use the GRADEpro. I mean, I think the GRADEpro started designing a new module due to this question itself. So this is a very nice example. It's in the paper. Another example is this tuberculosis guideline that I showed in the last tables. This is a WHO guideline assessing ventilation systems versus no ventilation, no? And then I showed the table, I think. But you can also find this in the guideline. And the references in the concept paper. And then the guideline made a hypothetical example on an NMA on the, I think it was idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, no? But then I don't think there are more examples right now that has already been published. I know Thomas Pijot is also working on an MS guideline that has used this approach. And the one that Bart has already mentioned that it's being conducted right now, but I don't have clearance to talk about that because it's not my guideline. So these are the examples that I can share for now that has used a great multiple comparison approach.
Thank you so much. So there is still a lot of questions about the use of the features in GRADEpro. And definitely you can contact us at either webinarsevidenceprime.com or support@gradepro.com. And these are our social media. You can follow us. And thank you again. Thank you. It was a great webinar.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you very much.